And then do you see? Yeah. Can you
Merry Christmas!
Welcome to Cloud of Witnesses.
Journey with the Saints.
You guys were really excited. This is our Christmas special 2023. Thank you for being here. We've got a number of our voice actors. We are about to record an episode that you may be hearing very soon. It's also the year anniversary. Yes. Thanks be to God indeed. So we've lasted a year, survived a year. So we are gathering really to celebrate Christmas. We're gonna be talking a little bit about nativity, talking about Christmas, as well as kind of reflecting on the fact that we're still doing this a year in. By God's grace, a lot of miracles later, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, and selfless volunteering, which is just awesome, which is why you may see some people holding up some gifts. Cloud of Witnesses is gifting some care packages to our crew, our cast, and we're very excited to share that with them.
We've got an episode to share with you guys, carols to sing, and we also have some gifts to open, so let's get started.
Wow. Awesome. I think we should all open at the same time, yeah? Okay. Three, two, one.
What's the noise?
Out of the back, huh?
Gifts, and you can see we all are wearing our brand new shirts. Thank you guys so much. We literally could not be doing this without each and every one of you guys. So we really greatly appreciate it. By the way, Nick, we would be remiss if we don't mention, obviously this is not all of our voice actors. Not everyone could be here tonight, of course, but we love all of our voice actors equally, and those that are not on this particular video, hopefully we'll catch you in some other things as well. We miss you guys. So, we are about to record
St. Boniface, the origin of the Christmas tree.
Awesome. We're going to do it right now. Enjoy.
Here is the thunder oak. And here, the cross of Christ shall break the hammer of the false god Thor.
Hello, and welcome to Cloud of Witnesses, Journey with the Saints, a dynamic full cast retelling of the lives of the saints.
We begin our story about the origin of the first Christmas tree from the life of Saint Boniface, the apostle of the Germans.
Upon the night of one Christmas Eve, Saint Boniface traversed along an old Roman road through the cold woods with a band of faithful companions tailing him from behind.
Father Boniface, I'm freezing! Can't we stop for the night, Father?
Come along, men. Do not lose heart.
Father!
In the year 718 AD, the holy and great Boniface was determined to bring the gospel to the lost souls of these lands.
His fervent desire moved him to act swiftly, and so, from Hampshire, England, he set out for the Holy and Apostolic See of Rome.
Holy Father, Pope Gregory, the lands of Germany are in dire need of enlightenment.
I give you my blessing to travel and bring those people to the light of Christ.
Thank you, Your Eminence.
Beware, though. There is a reason why darkness still hovers heavily over those lands. Don't be surprised if you stumble across their evil practices.
At the head of the band marched the holy and great Boniface, clad in a tunic of fur, with his long black robe girt high about his waist. His hunter's boots were crusted with snow.
There was no other ornament to his dress except the bishop's cross hanging over his breast.
He carried a strong, tall staff in his hand, fashioned at the top into the form of a cross.
Close beside him, keeping step like a familiar comrade, was the young Prince Gregor.
Long marches through the wilderness had stretched his limbs and broadened his back, and made a man of him in stature, as well as in spirit.
Father Boniface, surely this day's march is done. Is it time to eat and sleep? We can hardly see our steps in the depths of this snow.
Nay, my son Gregor, take courage. Cut across this tree that has fallen across the road. Our campground is not here.
With your blessing, Father.
Courage, brothers, and forward, yet a little. The moon will light us presently, and the path is plain.
Huh? Father, what was that?
This is the Yuletide, and the heathen people of the forest have gathered at the Thunder Oak of Geismar to worship their god Thor. Strange things will be seen there, and deeds which make the soul black. But we are sent to lighten their darkness, and we will teach these lost souls to keep a Christmas with us, such as the woodland has never known.
Huh? What was that, Father?
Father, where is everyone? Is this a ghost town in the middle of this eerie forest?
Forward, then, and let us stiffen up our feeble knees in God's name.
Then, as the travelers moved on, they came across a swelling hill crowned with a huge oak tree.
The Thunder Oak of Geismar.
What on God's blessed earth is that?
It looks to be a tree of sorts.
It towered above the land, a giant with contorted arms, beckoning to the hosts of lesser trees.
Here it is, my brothers. Here is the Thunder Oak, and here the cross of Christ shall break the hammer of the false god Thor.
An immense bonfire had been kindled in front of the tree.
It stood like a pillar of cloud between the still light of heaven and the crackling, flashing fire of earth.
A great throng of people were gathered around it, the dread oak tree of Geismar, an altar of sacrifice and blood.
It is an assembly of the tribe! This is where they went! Father, we must at least hide the cross, lest we be killed!
There is no cross I shall ever hide, for this is why we have come. These blind folk must see its power.
Father, we'll be killed.
I have seen this all in a dream. Here, the cross must stand and be our refuge. Come, let us move onward.
You'll be exposed. Do not enter that pagan den of wolves.
Oh, you of little faith. Greetings, ye sons of the forest. May I join you all around the warmth of your fire?
Swiftly, and as with a single motion, a thousand eyes gazed upon the saint.
Who are you?
The old priest of Thor, Hunrad, with his long robe, flowing hair and beard, advanced slowly to meet the strangers.
Whence do you come, and what seek you here?
I am your kinsman. I am of the German Brotherhood and from England beyond the sea. I come to bring you a greeting from that land and a message from the true God, the creator of the universe, of whom I am a servant.
Welcome then, kinsman. But be silent, for what will soon happen is too great to be stopped. It must be done before the moon crosses the middle of the night sky. Unless, are you able to work any miracles or spells?
Nay, miracles have I never wrought, though I have heard of many. My God has given me no power to work great wonders.
Stand still, then, thou common man. This is the hour of darkness and the power of winter. This is the night of our great Thor, to whom this oak is sacred. Our god Thor has been angry with our people because we have forsook his worship long ago. Because of this, we have been stricken by sickness and war. Is this not true, my people?
Yes!
After the fell chants of idolatrous praise faded, the people approached the dread altar of Thor,
offering jewels, javelins, garments, and the flesh of sheep and steed.
But Hunrad, looking at these offerings with a look of dissatisfaction, declared,
"None of these things will please our angered god. More precious is the crimson dew that shall send new life into this holy tree of blood. Thor claims your dearest and noblest gift."
Hunrad moved nearer to the handful of children who stood around the bonfire.
The priest's hand was laid upon the shoulder of the fairest boy from the group, Asulf, son of the Duke, to designate him for the sacrifice.
"Here is the chosen one, the eldest son of the prince, the darling of the people. Rejoice, you privileged child, bound by honor, for you go to Valhalla, where the heroes dwell with the gods, to bear a message to Thor."
"Mama? Papa? Is this it?"
"Yes, dear child. Go with courage. Our gods are waiting for you on the other side. When this displeasure against us is appeased by your sacrifice, son, you, my dear boy, will be placed among the brave and the bold. And you, my son, you will dine and feast with the gods to your soul's content."
"Why did it have to be you? Though it is a great honor for us to send you to the god. Go, dear child, my one and only asshole, and greet our gods for us."
Then the priest led the child to the altar.
He bound the child's eyes with a white cloth and bade him kneel beside the stone.
Unconsciously, the wide arc of spectators drew inward toward the center where the sacrifice was to be made.
Saint Boniface moved silently until he stood close behind the priest.
Hunrad stooped to lift a black hammer of stone from the ground, the sacred hammer of the god Thor.
Summoning all the strength of his withered arms, he swung it high in the air.
It poised for an instant above the child's fair head.
Then, as the hammer fell to complete the sacrifice,
"Stop!"
Saint Boniface's heavy staff thrust mightily against the hammer's handle as it fell.
Sideways, it fell from the old man's grasp, and the black hammer, striking on the altar's edge, split into two.
A shout of awe, relief, and joy rolled along the living circle.
The branches of the oak shivered. The flames leaped higher.
"The gods of the heathens are devils, and by God's grace I do not merely challenge them. I banish them from these lands in his name.
As the shout died away, the people saw the Lady Thecla with her arms clasped round her child.
"Mama! The man wearing the
me!
Oh, my darling Asaph! Stay with me!
And above them, on the altar stone, Saint Boniface, his face shining like the face of an angel.
Hearken, sons of the forest! No blood shall flow this night, for this is the birth night of Christ, the true Son of God the Father, the Savior of mankind. And now, on this Christ night, you shall begin to truly live. This blood tree shall darken your land no more. In the name of the Lord, I will cut it down!
Then the chief wonder in the life of Saint Boniface came to pass.
The saint took the axe from the hand of Prince Gregor and, striding to the oak, began to cut against it.
For as the bright blade circled above his head and the flakes of wood flew from the deepening gash in the body of the tree,
a whirling wind, as though it came from heaven, passed over the forest.
It gripped the oak from its foundations.
Backward, the dreaded tree fell like a tower,
groaning as it split asunder in four pieces.
Seen such a power, such true power. Thank you, Boniface, for revealing this truth to me and to my people.
But just behind it, and unharmed by the ruin,
stood a young evergreen fir tree, pointing a green spire towards the stars.
Saint Boniface let the axe drop and turned to speak to the people.
This little tree, a young child of the forest, shall be your holy tree tonight. It is the wood of peace, for your houses are built of the fir. It is the sign of an eternal life, for its leaves are evergreen. See how it points upward to heaven. Let this be called the tree of the Christ child.
This is what we shall do.
Gather about it, not in the wild wood, but in your own homes. There it will shelter no deeds of blood, but loving gifts and rites of kindness.
Yes, of course. Kindle those lights among the branches. Yes, more decorations. Deck the halls, everywhere.
Mama, it's so beautiful.
Father Boniface, tell us of the Christ child.
Well then, gather about and hear this story. A star came alight in the sky above the town of Bethlehem.
Holy Father Boniface, pray to God for us.
I used to always be the first one up Christmas morning. Super early, just waking everybody else up. Wake up, it's Christmas. Like, I'm just so excited.
That's great.
Yeah, so I'm sure that they were slightly annoyed, but it's Christmas, man, how can you lay there?
Yeah, seriously. I too remember, Joshua, those feelings of just so much excitement, you know? There was such a joy when you're younger, and there's that, and I don't know, that innocence that you just can't get back, you know, from experiencing it that way. That's a great memory.
I think in some ways, though, you can get it back in the sense that, you know, Western society has a glimpse of it when it comes to the gift giving, but oftentimes that's very vapid, right? And it doesn't last. But the true meaning of Christmas, right? And it's kind of cliche at this point, but really is Christ, right? Keep Christ in Christmas. And I think that innocence, to a large extent, maybe not as the world sees it, but you can still keep that true glimmer of Christmas through remembering and through participating in Christ's incarnation. Not that I want to deny what you're saying, Jeremy, because I definitely, as a child, it has this particular excitement and nostalgia.
Right.
I don't know. My mom would always, Christmas Eve, let us open one gift that we could have, because we wouldn't open our gifts later on Christmas until after we had had dinner with all our friends and everyone was gone.
So raise your hand if you got to open one present on Christmas.
Stockings.
Yeah. Stockings. Yes.
We had just gotten back from midnight mass, and Simone was so excited, but she was so excited, she was like crawling to the tree, and there's this picture of her reaching out, but she's like,
she fell asleep reaching for
the gift under the tree, and she was out.
Oh, that's good.
It's like burned in my memory.
Do you have a picture of it?
She was out.
The spirit is really
but the flesh is weak.
Exactly. That's it. That's great.
Yeah, my family did when I was like 8 or 9, and they made like a huge mess on Christmas Eve, and they framed it as if like Santa and his reindeers had broken into the house.
Oh my god!
The house was in a mess, and like food was all over the place.
That's funny.
We had set up like cookies and milk, you know, for Santa Claus and stuff like
that's
that.
That's funny.
And carrots for the reindeer. Oh. And so everything, like food was like all over the place and stuff like that. But now the presents were there too, under the tree and stuff like
that.
Blame
it on Santa.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah. I like that. I got my hat from my friend Dominique here. She loves me, and she got me this.
Christmas for me is it's a little different now, because it's a special time for me now because of what it means, in that it was when I got baptized into the church. As a kid, Christmas was like my favorite holiday, like most kids, I think. But then that kind of got like, I think, pushed to the back when I got into like my adolescence, and like I was really into Halloween and like, you know, horror and all that, and so Christmas kind of lost that special feeling. And then like now, like having come into the church and seeing the actual like true meaning behind Christmas, the nativity, the incarnation, that's like just brings it to a whole different level. And then on top of that, you know, having that memory of coming into the church and then getting ready to come back for liturgy, because it was Christmas Eve, coming back for liturgy, and then staying up all night to watch the sunrise.
That's awesome. That's cool.
Yeah. And, you know, that's doing special. The podcast and caroling. And
I like that Christmas too.
I was 8 years old.
He just goes into it. I was 8 years old.
My parents put me to bed. And then they knew full well that I was still awake. So I was just closing my eyes, thinking that Santa would know if I didn't. So what they did was put on a show, a little skit, right in earshot distance, because they knew that I would listen to it. And my dad just pretended to be Santa Claus. It was all in Korean. They were speaking in Korean. Wow. So I was like, okay, Santa knows.
Wait a second, so your dad was a voice actor? Cool. Let me get that right.
Well, yeah.
That's kind of cool.
That is cool.
And he would just say, yeah, hello, hello there. I mean, this is a rough translation. I've got a gift for our dear John.
Oh.
Oh, he's left me some cookies and milk. Let me finish this first. So here's your present. I'm gonna go now. And then he just pretended to go up the chimney.
Wow. Oh, that's sweet.
That's pretty good. That's really cool.
That's cute.
I was like, why does he sound like that? The childlike imagination didn't allow me to kind of put the two into together.
Interesting.
I was thinking logically about it. Right. I genuinely was convinced it was him.
Oh. Yeah.
So that actually makes me think of a story. It's actually my mom's story.
Yeah.
So when my mom got to the age where my nana wanted to tell her, you know, there's no Santa Claus, how she said it to try to break it to Reese is, honey, your dad is Santa Claus. So she took it literally.
Yeah. And she goes to school and she's telling all her friends that her dad is Santa Claus.
That's cool.
So I'm from Russian Orthodox Church, and we celebrate Christmas 7 January. And I don't know why, but I had two gifts on 7 January and 25. And 25 small from Santa Claus, and on 7 like bigger. But I loved more smaller square things on 25 December.
I'm gonna celebrate both this year. Those of you guys here listening, I celebrate both. Yes, thank you very much. I have a younger sister, and what I would do every year, probably did it for 5-6 years straight, is whenever I got her, let's say I got her something this size, the box in the living room would be the size of Joshua.
Oh, really?
And I did layer after layer after layer.
Kind of like
duct tape. Yes, and just, I mean, she honestly been an hour and a half.
No
trying
way.
To open up,
no
to
way.
Get to the candy. But it got to the point where she genuinely, yeah, I know, right? She genuinely enjoyed it to the year where I actually didn't do it. She was like, you didn't do, you know, she's like, you didn't do the layer, so.
That's
I think she enjoyed it, you know. Thank you for being here right now, listening to this. We hope you're enjoying our Christmas special so far. Maybe we're gonna go to another Christmas carol right now.
Yeah, let's start the recording now. These things always make my head so
yeah.